Okay, so in this lecture we are going to see how pointers are used in C++ programs. So I'm not going to spend too much time on it. I believe all of you have already gone through this. So there is no point doing that. We are not keeping track of that. Yeah. So here is a simple program which is there in the slides, has integer variables, pointer to integers and pointer to integers. And did anybody have any problem going through? So of course in the video lectures we have explained in great detail what exactly happens as each statement is executed. But did anybody have a problem going through this program? No, if not then we will just, you know, skip it, because this is actually completely straightforward, right? I mean, there is a pointer int which once takes the value of n, another time takes the value of m, and pointer int always points to pointer int. So in this case star pointer int is pointing to pointer int and pointer int is pointing to n, and in the other case pointer int is pointing to pointer int and pointer int is pointing to m, and so the values of n and m are printed out. Okay, so we'll just skip this because this is fairly straightforward if you've understood what ampersand and pointers are about. The point I want to sort of bring to your attention is that when we use star pointer, it is not that we can just read the contents of the memory at the specified location. We can also write the contents of memory at that location. So here is the expression b plus c, whose value is being stored in the memory location whose address is pointer A. Okay, and then here is another program which also does something fairly straightforward. So there is this integer variable called sum, and the address of that is stored in pointer sum, and then pointer int once stores the address of n and another time stores the address of m. And here, so this statement star pointer sum plus equal to star pointer int is basically this. We have already seen what plus equals mean long back. So in this case I'm going to access the value of star pointer sum, which is 0, and star pointer int, which is the value of n, and add them and store them in the memory location whose address is given by pointer sum. And the next time around I'm going to do the same thing, but this time of course pointer int is pointing to m. So basically the values of m and n are added, and that's what gets printed out when that statement is executed. So did anybody have a problem understanding this in the video lecture? So let's go to the next one. So this is about pointers and functions. So basically we have studied functions before mid-sem itself, and when we talk about functions we can talk about passing parameters either by value or by reference, right? And we also know that whenever a function is called, an activation record for that function is created. What goes in the activation record? All the local variables, space for all the local variables, the return program counter, the return value of the program counter, and some other bookkeeping information, and this entire activation record is pushed into the call stack. And the call stack resides in the stack segment. So the question is, can we pass pointers as function parameters and can we return pointers from functions? Now if pointers are legitimate types, I mean I'm defining variables of type pointers, so if pointers are legitimate types then it should be possible to pass arguments of pointer type to a function and also for a function to return something of pointer type. So here is a simple one which is swap by pointer. So here I want to swap the values of m and n, which are two integer variables in main, and if I write swap in which I pass the values of m and n by value, then we have seen earlier before mid-sem that what's going to happen is inside swap the local copies of m and n will have their values swapped, but when the function returns main will not be able to see the values swapped, right? So here is one way of actually letting this function, the called function, access local variables of the calling function. So you actually pass the pointers, ampersand n and ampersand n will give you the addresses of m and n. So you pass these pointers to the called function, and then the called function then manipulates the memory at those addresses using the star operator. This is fairly straightforward, right? And that's what is basically illustrated here. So this is the activation record of main, which has m and n, and there are two addresses. corresponding to M and N, and this is the activation record of swap by pointer. And when I'm passing the addresses of M and N, what is getting copied in the, you know, these are the spaces allocated for the formal parameters of swap by pointer. So what is getting copied there are the addresses of M and N. And now that swap by pointer has the addresses of two local variables in the activation record of main, it can actually use the star operator to go and access those variables, read their values, change their values, whatever. And then that's what exactly happens. And that's how the values of M and N are changed in the activation record of main by the function swap by pointer, by a different function. Right? And if you recall, we were able to do something like this earlier by using parameter passing by reference. Here we are passing parameters. So what is this? This is passing parameters by what? Is it by value or by reference? How many of you think it's reference? Value? And there is some undecided yet. So for those of you who are undecided, this ampersand M is an expression we talked about last time. So this is an expression which evaluates to a pointer type. This is an expression which evaluates to a pointer type. And this is a function call where the two expressions values are being passed using call by value. So the called function, which in this case is swap by pointer, is going to get two values copied, the address of M and the address of N copied from the main function here. So this is really call by value. Okay? I have found out the addresses of M and N and I have copied those values here in the formal parameters for swap. Okay. The point that I was saying is that passing parameters by reference also accomplishes this. And it's interesting that when you actually write a function call where you pass parameters by reference, behind the scenes the compiler is actually using something like what we just saw. It's actually passing pointers to those variables so that the called function has access to the local variables of the calling function. However, passing parameters by reference is not exactly the same as passing parameters as pointers, call by value through pointers. And there are some subtle differences, we won't get into those. But there is a quick sort of comparison of how the two things might look like. So here is the main function, and here we have written two functions, swap by pointer and swap by reference. They are both doing the same thing, swapping the values of the two arguments passed as parameters. In this case, I'm calculating the addresses of M and N, passing them using call by value, and then using the star operator to directly access the variables M and N over here. And in this case, I'm calling them directly as M and N, but when I write the function here, I say that these are parameters called by reference. So note the difference. When I'm calling by reference, I don't do anything where it is called, but in the function definition, I indicate that these are call by reference. When I'm passing pointers, I calculate the pointers here, and in the function, I say that these are pointer valued parameters, which are being copied by value. So of course, you could pass pointer valued parameters by reference also, right? So both of these functions do the same thing, but I guess this is a slightly cleaner way of doing it. Here, you don't need to keep saying star, star, star all over. You just need to say right here when you're declaring the parameters that these are parameters by reference. It's also cleaner when you call it here. You don't need to compute the addresses. So that's why parameter passing by reference is preferred most of the times than parameter passing by pointer values. However, you can use both. Can a function return a pointer? So if pointer is a legitimate type, then certainly it can. But you need to be careful about what pointer value you are returning. So for example, here is a function which has a local variable A, and it is returning the address of that local variable A. Right? So this local variable is going to reside in the activation record of this function in the stack segment. So as long as this function call is active, that activation record is there, and the variable A has a legitimate address, and you can talk about ampersand A being a legitimate address. But the moment this function call returns, that activation record is gone. It's popped out of the call stack. So the space allocated for A is also now freed up. It no longer necessarily belongs to A. The operating system is free to allocate it to somebody else if it wants. From the same program, somebody else might require that space. So after the function call returns, the address of the variable A is really the address of something that had some meaning earlier, but no longer has a meaning once the function has returned, right? So when you try to dereference that address here as star A, right? So this is whatever, my func is being called with some integer pointer and it is returning some pointer value which is the address of this local variable. And when you're trying to dereference that over here, you'll have a problem because you're really dereferencing a bad address. What does it mean? That it's an address which had some meaning, those locations had some meaning when the function was called, when the function was active, but when the function is returned, that entire activation record has been freed up. So those locations do not necessarily have the same meaning that they had when the function was active, when the function call was active. So there could be something else stored here, and so if you write star A, it's going to print out something, but it could be garbage. It may not be what the value of the local variable here was. However, here is an alternative function where what it is doing is it's taking an integer pointer and it's actually returning that same integer pointer back. It's doing some calculation in between, it's whatever, calculating the square of the integer over there, storing it there, and it's returning that same integer pointer back. So if you look at it, I've passed an integer pointer here, which is actually the address of a local variable in main, right? Now my func is going to basically square the value of B, store it back in B, and again it's going to return the same pointer that was passed to it, right? Pointer B was passed to it, it's going to return that same pointer. So the address of B was passed to it, so it will return the address of B. So A now contains the address of B, and B is a local variable of main. So when I do star A, I will actually get the value of B. But it is the value of B after some updates have happened over here, right? So this is a legitimate dereferencing. Okay, is that clear? So that's all that we had in this lecture. Are there any doubts about this? Okay, so let's start the quiz. Okay, so that's the first question. Consider the following function call. Int ABs, you're reading in the values of A and B, and then you're calling a function using ampersand A and ampersand B. So we have just discussed this. So parameters are being passed here by which mechanism? If a function F1 calls a function F2, which of the following are possible? F2 can change the values of local variables of F1. F2 cannot change the values of local variables of F1. F1 can change the values of local variables of F2 other than the formal parameters of F2. The formal parameters of F2 are also local variables of F2. So this says that F1 can change values of local variables of F2 other than the formal parameters of F2, and none of the above. Which of the following are true of function calls in C++? Can accept pointers as parameters, can return a pointer, cannot dereference, it should not be deference, cannot dereference pointers passed as parameters, and cannot return a pointer if pointers are passed as parameters. So a swap function that swaps the values of two integer variables in the calling function can be implemented by passing parameters by reference, value, or the value could be value of a pointer, both A and B, and none of the above. And a function F1 returns a pointer to a local variable of F1. If F2 calls F1 and tries to dereference the pointer returned by F1, which of the following may happen? Memory access error during runtime, no error during runtime, reading of garbage value by F2, and none of the above. Okay, so now we'll start our practice questions. So let's see, we have 45 minutes. Let's be a bit ambitious and try to attempt three practice questions, okay? So here is a code snippet. What I'd request all of you is to write down this in your notebook, because there is another part of the code snippet on the next slide. So please write this down. This is a function which takes an integer pointer and an integer, and then it does some things. And here you see that it also calls itself recursively. So now we want to invoke this function from the main function in the following way. So in the main function, we want to have an integer pointer variable p, and there's an integer variable q which has to be initialized to something, and then we want to call that function fun that you just saw in this manner. Okay, and we want to print out the value of star t. So the question is, what value of this question mark will cause dereferencing of a bad address when trying to print star p, and what value of question mark will avoid this problem, and what is the value output in that case? Right, when you're dereferencing a bad address, there is no guarantee on what value you will be outputting. But when you're not dereferencing a bad address, then you should be able to say what value you're putting on. Please try it on by yourself first, write down in your notebook, and then after a few minutes we'll ask you to swap your notebooks, and then we'll have a discussion. So I have a sample answer here. Yeah, so what he's saying is that if you put q is 0, if you initialize the value of q with 0, so then what's going to happen is you'll get ampersand q, and q is initialized to 0 and 0. These are the two arguments, and here star of ampersand q will be just the value of q, and b is already 0, so 0 equals 0, so it will return a, which is the address of q, right? So p will get the address of q, and then when you try to dereference p, you are fine, because q is already a local variable in the main function. However, if it is something other than 0, int q is any value other than 0 something, okay? Yeah, so I guess what he's trying to say is that if you use a value other than 0 over here, so what exactly is going to happen? So suppose I say q is 5 over here. So this will be ampersand q and 0. So here I have the address of q and here I have 0. And star of the address of q will give me the value of q, which is, let's say, 5, something other than 0. And that is not equal to 0. So it will go into the else part. And in the else part, what will it return? It will make a recursive call to func ampersand c, c. C is a local variable of this function, right? So what is that going to return? So it will enter this function again, and now it will try to do star of ampersand c. So it will get the value of c, which is 0, and this c is also 0. So does everybody see that when this call is made, the recursion will stop, because c already has the value 0. So when I make that recursive call with the address of c, and then when I take star of that address, I will actually get the value of 0 here, and this is also 0. So this condition will get satisfied. And so it will just return the address of c. Okay? Right? So what happens is, you make a call which is, let us say, func of ampersand q and 5. So p is assigned this, and inside func what happens is we are trying to check if star of ampersand q is equal to 5, then you return ampersand q. Right? This ampersand q is the first parameter of func. Else you return func of ampersand c and c, where c was initialized to 0 as a local variable. Oh, right? So what does this call do? This call itself, you know, another call here. So it also sets its own copy of the local variable c to 0. And then it says if star of ampersand c is equal to 0. Remember, the value of c here that was passed was the value of c, which is 0. And this is the address of c, from the activation record of the first call to func, right? So we are asking if star of ampersand of c is equal to 0, and indeed the value of c in the activation record of the first function call is 0. So this is, so it will return ampersand c, right? So since this is indeed equal to 0, so it will return ampersand c. So this function will return the address of c in the first call to func. This is the second call to func, which will return the address of c in the activation record of the first call to func. And therefore, from here, it will return that same address back here. Is that clear? So the second call to func returns the address of c in the activation record of the first call to func. And when it returns that, that value is returned directly back to the main function. So here what I get is the address of c in this first, in the activation record of the first call to func. But by the time I return here, the activation record of the first call to func is gone. So therefore, p will get assigned the address of a non-existent variable. And so when you try to dereference it, you'll be dereferencing a bad address. Is this clear to everybody? This is the first call to func. This is the second call to func. First call. And this is the func second call. The value returned from the second call to func is actually a legitimate address inside the first func call, because it is the address of a local variable in the activation record of the first call to func. But the value returned by the first call to func is not a legitimate address in main, because it's the address of a variable in the activation record of the first call to func, which is gone by the time the first call to func returns. Are there any doubts about this? I mean, this is a very simple example of how pointers can be shipped back and forth across functions. Okay. So let's look at the second question. We are doing okay with respect to time. Okay, so the second question actually builds upon what we had already seen in the last class. Okay, so in the last class, we used one-dimensional arrays to store data in such a way that we could access the data as a two-dimensional array, right? For example, in order to access a 10 by 10 array of int, actually Govind showed us last time that we could actually do this. Actually, several of you also came up with this solution independently. So we could, so to access a 10 by 10 array of int, we used 10 one-dimensional integer arrays, and then we used one one-dimensional integer pointer array in which we initialized them with the address of the first element. Instead of writing ampersand a1 0, you could also write a1, which will also give you the address of the first element in a1, but this is being very explicit, saying take the first element in a1, find its address. Okay. Of course, these dot dot dots are not legitimate in C++. You have to write A310, A410, and so on. I've just written this here to save space. Okay. This is what we did in last class. This is what Govind showed us in last class. So now what we want to do is, we want to write a function, call that function get2darray, and it will take two parameters, two integer parameters, n1 and n2, and it will return a pointer to a pointer to an integer. And what we want, how we want to use this function is, I mean, this is a sort of example usage of this function. So I'm saying get2darray 10, 10. So this should give me back something which I can use as a 10 by 10 two dimensional array. So for example, I could have these two nested for loops, and I could do something like this. So recall that last time also we had said that we should be able to access the array like this. And that's what we are insisting this time also. But now we want this function which should take these as parameters, and it should return us back something which we can then use over here. Is that clear? So it's really the same thing, but now you realize that it's going to be a bit different, I mean, not too much different, but a bit different from what Govind had shown, because there he knew that it was a 10 by 10 array, so he could declare 10 such arrays. But here I might say 10, 10 now, and I might say 100-100 next time, or I might say 30-10 the third time. So I cannot predefine a certain number of arrays, right? Here, since we knew this was a 10-10, we predefined 10 arrays, each of size 10. But here, this is somewhat inside the parameter, okay? Now, you may assume, you know, when you're writing this function get 2D array, you may assume that you have access to the following black box functions. What do we mean by black box functions? These are functions like, you know, coming from a library. So you can use them, you know their contract behavior, but you do not care or you do not know about how they are implemented. So what are these two black box functions? One is a get one dimensional integer array, int n, and the other is get one dimensional integer pointer array, int n. So each of these functions may be assumed to return a pointer to an array that can be accessed even after the function returns. Okay, now from whatever we have learned so far, this looks like something that requires something beyond whatever we have learned so far. That I'll call this function and it will return me an array, and then I can access that array even after that function returns, after its activation record is gone. But let us assume for the time being that we have some such functions. So let us just for the time being assume that you have these two functions given to you. When you call this function with 5 over here, it returns you an integer pointer which you can use as the address of the starting element of an integer array of size n, whatever that n is. And similarly, whenever you call this function, it returns you an array of integer pointers, and the size of that array of integer pointers is n, whatever the parameter you pass to that. So is this clear? So I want you to write this function such that I can use it in the main function like this, and in writing this function you are allowed to use these two functions in whatever ways you want without worrying about how those functions are implemented. We'll look at their implementations in the next class itself. So when you write C out less than n, do you ask how does C out work? So I'm saying what that function will do. Oh, so it's written here. It returns a pointer to an array. Of course, this is returning a pointer to an array of integers. This is returning a pointer to an array of integer pointers. That can be accessed even after the function returns. So for example, suppose I call this function and I assign the return value of this function to A. So if I write A assign get 1D int array 100, then after that statement I can write A5 is assigned 3. Whatever it has returned is now an integer array of size 100. Similarly, this one is an integer pointer array of size whatever. So once you call this and it returns something and you copy that return value somewhere, you can use that thing now as an array of integers or integer pointers of whatever size you have specified. Okay, so I'm not sure if we can go into the third problem, but there is really nothing much difficult about this problem. So let me show solution of Govind again. So here was last time solution, right? We had asked you to build a 10 by 10 array, and so what we did is we went and declared 10 arrays, each of size 10, and we filled up, and each of these was an integer array. So we basically needed some integer arrays and we needed an integer pointer array. So these two functions are exactly for that, to get the integer arrays and to get the integer pointer array, right? Here we had statically, or while writing the program itself, we had declared all of these 10 integer arrays. And how did we know that we had to use 10 integer arrays? Because it was a 10 by 10 array we were trying to use. And the size of each of these 10 integer arrays was 10 because we knew that this was going to be a 10 by 10 array. Right? So now, in our case, we want an n1 by n2 array. So how would you do an n1 by n2 array? Using the same idea, perhaps you would have n1 arrays, each of size n2. Right? So if I could declare n1 arrays, each of size n2, and then I could put all of those n1 arrays, the address of the starting element of all of those n1 arrays, into this array of size n2, but it's now an array of integer pointers, then we'd be done, right? An n1 by n2 array is basically n1 arrays of size n2, and then put the address of the starting element of each of those n1 arrays into another array, which is an array of integer pointers as of size n1, right? So that's exactly what we're going to do, and that is all that is there. So I mean, if you understood this solution, there is really nothing much here. So he is getting the one-dimensional integer pointer array, right? So we said n1 by n2 means n1 arrays of size n2, and then the address of the starting element of each of these n1 arrays will be stored in the resulting array, which will be an integer pointer array. So that's what he is doing here. He is having this integer pointer array of size n1, which he is calling as A, and then each element of that array that he got here should contain an array of size n2, and this should be an integer array of size n2. Right? I mean, we are just trying to replicate what we did here. I mean, n1 by n2 array means n1 arrays of size n2. Each of these arrays is an integer array, and we store the starting address of each one of these into an array of integer pointers. Right? So the point to remember here, yeah, maybe let me emphasize this. So the point to remember here is that you know, when we say there is an integer array of size 5, let us say. Right? When we declare an integer array of size 5, A3 is an integer, A0 is an integer, these types are integer types, but A itself is of type integer star. Okay? In fact, A0 is the same as star of A plus 0. A3 is the same as star of A plus 3, and if you recall the pointer arithmetic business I just told you in the lecture, A plus 3 means if A is an integer star, A plus 3 means it will actually add 3 times 4, because each integer would require 4 locations, right? So it will calculate the address which is given by the value of A plus 3 times how many ever locations are needed to store an integer, because A is an integer pointer. Okay, so when we are saying that we are returning an array A, we are really returning an integer pointer. I mean, if A is an integer array. So if I have an integer pointer array, let us say B, size 10, then B0, B1, all of these are integer pointers up to B9. These are all integer pointers, but B itself is an integer pointer. So that B0 is really star of B plus 0, B1 is star of B plus 1, where the plus 1 really means find out the type of what B is pointing to, find out how many locations it takes, and plus 1 means one more unit of that many locations. So what is this? This is an integer array of size 5. So therefore, what should be this? This is an integer pointer array of size 10. I mean, whatever I write here, if I had written char here, it would become a character array of size 6, whatever. So this is a type, right? So int star is a type. So this is saying this is an array of this much size. Each element of that array is an integer. So this is an array of this much size. Each element in that array is an integer pointer. So this is an array of integer pointers. Right? I mean, this is the general format for declaring any array. You provide the type, you give the array name, and then you give the size. Right? So for example, if I write int star 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 b10, so this is an array of 10 elements, and each element is of type int star star star. If I write it like this, that's what I mean. That's what it means in C++. Okay? So therefore, each element in this array is going to be of type int star star star. If I have declared it like this. So here, each element of the array B will be of type int star. So B0 through B9 are of type int star. And B will be a pointer to that type. Because as I said, B0 is really star of B plus 0. So the type of this is obtained by dereferencing B. The value of this is obtained by dereferencing B. So therefore B should be a pointer to whatever the type of B0 is. If the type of B0 is int star, then B's type should be a pointer to int star, which is int star star. Is that clear? So here in this case, the type of B will be int with 4 stars. Star of B will have this type. Because star of B plus 0, which is the same as star of B, is really B0. Star of B plus 0, which is the same as star of B, is the same as B0. So if this thing is of type int star star star, then B must be a pointer to int star star star, because star of B is int star star star. So B must be the address of something which is an int star star star, and therefore B must be of int star 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 star. So okay, I guess we have already overshot the time.